I hear you have $1,000 to invest, but you're not quite sure how to do it. This video is for you. Hey beautiful people, it's Courtney. I'm gonna show you how I would invest my first $1,000 today if it was the first investment I ever made. And I'm also gonna share with you what I did do with my first investments, where those accounts are now, did I make money, did I lose money, would I recommend the same strategy that I originally had so many years ago? We're gonna cover it all. And it goes without saying, I'm not a professional, this is just my own personal opinion and what I've done myself. So do with this information what you will, and always do your own research. Let's just hop right into it. So before I even thought about investing, and what I would also recommend you do as well, is to make sure you already have your emergency fund taken care of before you even think about investing. So this should be 3 to 6 months of expenses. And when I say expenses, I don't mean money for you to go out to eat every month, because that is not a necessity, but enough to get you by if you absolutely had to. For me, I like to have a little bit more on the high side, definitely more towards that 6 months. So for me, the amount I'm comfortable with in my emergency fund is $25,000. For me, my income can fluctuate quite a bit month to month, just because I am self-employed and have my own business. So I don't have like a set income every month. So I also like to budget a bit for that, just in case an emergency comes up. Now, why wouldn't I take that $25,000 and just go ahead and invest it? One, peace of mind. Two, if I needed that emergency fund like next week, if something came up, I want to have access to it immediately. It might take you a few days to pull money out of your account and get it transferred back into your bank account. So that's one thing. But the second major thing is the fact that the stock market might be down at the time, whether it's just down that week, whether it's down that year, because there are bad years as well. And if you just put it in, you don't have enough time to really gain a lot. So you might actually be taking a loss if you're pulling that money out right away. And one more thing that I want to put out there that I hope is the main takeaway from this video is to start investing now. If you happen to be a preteen or teen or even a child watching this video, I know there's probably not too many of you, but if there is, start now. I wish I would have. I am very glad I started like in my later teens, early 20s investing. I know a lot of people don't start to their 30s, 40s, 50s, if ever. I really wish when I was a kid that I would have put at least 50%, because let's be real, I wasn't gonna save all the money I ever got from birthdays, Christmases, holidays, chores, any of that. I wish I would have at least put 50% away. So here's just a small example on a really small scale of how much compound interest could help you, especially if you're a kid. So if you're a kid and you can save $300 in an entire year, over the course of the next 18 years with a 10% return, you would have only invested $5,400, but your account would be worth over $15,000. That's a great start to a down payment on your first home, maybe your college fund. It just really adds up. This is something I plan to do for my kids once we have kids, and maybe you're a parent watching this, start now. Do it for them. And then that way, if you're worried about their college expenses, wedding, houses, you could have that money for them without really investing a whole lot. It's just time is on your side. All right, so we got all of that out of the way. Let's talk about investing. I have two main options and kind of a third. So when you're listening to this video, maybe see which one best fits you and what you want to do. And then you could also do some more research and see if that's right for you. So I wanted to break this down three ways and make it as simple as possible. Option number one is what I would recommend if you are self-employed or have your own business, or maybe just your own side hustle that's bringing in a decent amount of money. When I invested my first $1,000, this is the option I went with because I wanted a tax break on the lovely self-employment tax. And that was to invest in an IRA. Now there's three main types of IRAs. I'll tell you what I did and I'll kind of briefly break down what each one does. The first thing I invested in was a traditional IRA. Now what this does is it saves you tax money you would have to pay this year now. And every year, or not quite every year, but the limits do change. It used to be $5,500. The past 2 years, it's been a $6,000 limit. So every year you can invest up to that amount. So say you invest the most, you invest $6,000 in a traditional IRA. This is $6,000 you do not have to pay taxes on. A traditional IRA is good if you think you're making more now than you will come retirement time, because come retirement time, when you take this money out, all you have to do is pay taxes on the gains of that money. Number two is Roth IRAs, which you hear a lot about when you're first starting off investing, because you can't make more. Again, the limits change. Right now, I believe that you can't make more than $125,000 a year to be able to put that $6,000 contribution into a Roth IRA. This is different. You're still gonna pay taxes on that $6,000, but when you go to take it out of that account, you don't have to pay any taxes. Now, for my first few years of investing, all I really did was max out my traditional IRA for the first few years, and that's all I could really afford. It helped me out a little bit with tax, and the rest I was just trying to save when I could. So after that, I started to hear about a SEP IRA, which I don't know why I didn't hear about it at the time. When you're self-employed, this is an amazing retirement option because every year you can save up to $57,000 and put it into this account. Now, you are only allowed to put in 25% of what you make. So say you make $100,000 a year, you could put in $25,000 into this account, all the way up to $57,000. So this is what I now do because it allows me to input more than that $6,000 limit in a traditional IRA. So if you do get the max, if you do contribute up to $57,000, that's $57,000 you do not have to pay taxes on now, which is amazing. So I started investing in 2014 when I was about 20 years old, and in 2017 is when I transferred it to Wealthfront, which is what I continue to use for my IRA. The biggest selling point for me was Wealthfront's fees were 0.25% to have them manage your account completely. You don't have to do anything. It's just like a robo investor versus an actual person financial advisor. They're usually around 1%. Another great thing is when I first started, so if you're deciding you want to open a Wealthfront account, you get your first $5,000 managed for free. So if you put in $6,000, you're only paying 0.25% on that extra $1,000. That's over $5,000. So I'll leave my link down below and that will allow you to get your $5,000 managed for free. Let's take a look at my traditional IRA. This is what I was maxing out every year before I decided to switch to a SEP IRA. So I transferred this over to Wealthfront in 2017 and I only put a little bit over $19,000 in this account. So that's a couple years worth of maxing it out. And then I stopped putting anything in this account for the past couple years when I switched over to a SEP IRA. It's made almost $10,000, which is pretty cool for not really putting in a whole lot of money. All right, so that summarizes my first investment, but maybe you're not self-employed. Maybe you don't want these tax breaks or advantages, and that's totally fine. With option two, you're not gonna get those tax benefits, but you won't have any penalties if you decide to withdraw it early, which does happen with an IRA. If you withdraw it early, you're subject to fees because it's meant to be a retirement account. So with this, you could withdraw if you're up and you just wanna take that money out, totally fine, no penalty, nothing. So I use Webull, which always sounds weird, B-U-L-L, Webull. And I used to use Robinhood, everything that kind of happened, switched over to Webull. I was kind of already thinking about it because they do have a lot more options when you're trying to trade stocks. Now, I'll leave my link down below, and if you choose to use it, you will get two free stocks when you sign up and invest over $100. When I first signed up, I think I got maybe like $30 worth of free stock, and you're free to do with that whatever you want. If you wanna sell those and invest it in something else, if you wanna keep them, you could really do anything, and it's just free stocks for coming to their platform. So I think what a lot of people think is they wanna take $1,000 and they wanna buy some of their favorite companies, Facebook, Walmart, Apple, Amazon, whatever. That $1,000 is not gonna get you very far. So essentially it could get you maybe a share of Microsoft for about $230, a share of Apple for around $120, Facebook $260, Boeing $220, Walmart around $130. And there goes your $1,000. You got one share of five companies and that's it. So instead of that, what if you could buy a fraction of the top 500 companies in the US? I'd say that's a lot better option. You have a lot more risk management that way. If one of those five stocks were to just tank, that could just ruin your whole portfolio. So I prefer to invest in index funds and ETFs. There's a lot of terms and a lot of stuff when it comes to investing. And to keep it really simple, you could research that for days. I like to invest in ETFs just because you could trade them like normal stocks. You could buy and sell them throughout the day, no issue, just like a normal stock. The top three ETFs I would recommend looking into follow the three major indexes, which are going to be the Dow Jones, the S&P 500, and the NASDAQ. For me, I don't like to invest in the Dow Jones. It has worse returns than the other two. And what I like to focus on is I do a split between the S&P 500 and the NASDAQ, and that's where you're gonna have to decide where you want your first $1,000 to go. Of course, you could split it however way you like, or you could just pick one. The S&P 500 has more companies in it. It has 500 versus the NASDAQ, which has 100. The S&P 500 does have 500 companies in it, so it manages your risk a little more versus the NASDAQ that just has 100 companies. But the NASDAQ has outperformed it for like the past 5 to 10 years. Some of the reasons I think people are maybe a little bit intimidated to start investing is because there is so many options. So I'm just gonna give you like my top two picks and you can decide from there. So if you type in the S&P 500 ETF on Webull, it gets a little confusing because you'll see there's actually multiple options. Some of these focus on short-term gains, some of them long-term gains, some of them dividends. And what I think is just the best route to go is to find one that captures the whole market, which is VOO. And that's gonna be like the true S&P 500, all 500 companies. So what I actually invest in is VOOG, which is a growth ETF. And this doesn't do all 500 companies. It kind of diversifies it and you get about 250 or 260 different companies within it. The annual returns on VOOG have been higher since it is focused more on growth and it actually is less risk as well. It's also important to note that those 260 companies also don't all pull the same weight. So your top 10 companies are gonna be companies such as Tesla, Apple, Google, etc. And those 10 companies actually pull more than 28% of the weight for that asset. So you could see they're not evenly distributed. So if you wanna go with the S&P 500, those two are great options. You don't have to get so lost in all the different variations of them. If you want to go with the NASDAQ, I like QQQ ETF, which is just the basic NASDAQ 100. Again, same concept with the top 100 companies. So to summarize option two, I would recommend getting into some ETFs. And you saw my two options, but there is tons to choose from. These are great for longer term growth to kind of minimize your risk. And this is something I invest into every single month. Now, if that decided maybe like a little too much to decide, it still seemed maybe a little confusing, or you don't want to do the research into those ETFs, here's where option three comes in. I would recommend going to a robo-investor. And like I said, I like Wealthfront. And on there, you could open more than just an IRA account. You could actually open up just an individual investment account. And so this will work very similarly where you could take it out anytime without penalty. And what's great is they will actually diversify this for you and they will allocate your funds different ways and in different percentage points based on your risk tolerance. So I have a higher risk tolerance just because I'm investing for the long term and I have a lot more time to get to where I want to be. If I was trying to pull out this money in the next year or two or even five, I would have a much lower risk tolerance. For every dollar, they'll break it down into these categories by percentage. So you'll be investing in US stocks, foreign stocks, real estate, dividend stocks, bonds, etc. This is a great well-balanced way to invest and minimize your risk because you're going a little bit into everything. So if foreign markets are hit, hopefully the US markets are a little better or vice versa. So you could really minimize your risk there. And the best part is they do it all for you. You don't really get a say in any of it. They just manage it all. And as I mentioned, I've been very happy with my returns in my IRA accounts. These are broken down in the same exact categories. So I've actually made in the past 3 full years, 60% return in my SEP IRA, which I am very happy with. And that is it. So there we go. Those are our three options. Option number one, if you're self-employed, possibly look into an IRA. Option number two, invest yourself on a brokerage such as Webull. Another thing I completely forgot to mention about Webull is the fact that every time you buy or sell a stock, an ETF, anything, there is zero fees. A lot of times, a lot of larger brokerage accounts, they charge like $7 to $9 per trade, which really cuts into your profits. So that's another reason I really like Webull. More and more websites are coming out where they have $0 trades, which is really great. And my third option is if you don't want to think about it, you don't want to manage it, you don't really want to do anything except put money into the account, then go on to Wealthfront and open an investment account. And that way it works very similarly to Webull, but they manage it themselves. Hopefully one of the three options I shared today will fit well with you and resonate with you, where maybe you could do a little more research on it. and invest some money today. So I hope you guys found this video helpful. Let me know what you thought in the comments down below, and I will see you Saturday for a brand new video. Bye.